Okay, so I was just told that there will be no bouillabaisse. So maybe we can do the Russian songs. What do you say?
I'm not so sure, so about
So,
organization.
this part is about adaptation. So I hope you will be able to follow it when you haven't seen the first part. It should be okay, but of course you can always ask. So is it okay with the sound and everything?
Looks good,
Yeah, it's
yeah.
perfect.
Okay. So let's look at again at the lasso, but now a little bit different perspective. So it looks like this. I take an estimator is going to be the minimizer of least squares loss in n-dimensional space. It's so you have a vector of observations y. You want to estimate its mean. And then there is a penalty of the form d of f, which is the L1 norm of certain linear combinations of the function f or vector f, and where d that's a matrix, a given matrix, it's called an analysis matrix. Okay. And then remember so that I wrote the true function is going to be I'll say function all the time, but it's really a vector. The true function is an n-dimensional vector, and that's what we want to estimate using this procedure. And the matrix D is, for instance, taking first order differences, and then you have a total variation penalty, but in general, I will look at problems like this is work which I've been doing with Francesco Ortelli. And so at first we looked at here total variation. Then later we looked at higher order total variation, so discrete derivatives of all orders. And then we looked at higher dimensional extensions. So in the end, we were able to do higher order derivatives in higher dimensions. So I would just want to show you the lower dimensions and some simple cases, otherwise it will be taking too long. So let's look again at the basic inequality. Let me write it again, yeah, the one from Kolchinsky et al., which says f hat minus the true function plus for any f star, so for all other functions, which can be an oracle, you have this is bounded by f star, so the approximation error, so to speak. And then comes this penalty to lambda df star. And then I subtract penalty for the estimator. And then there's the noise. And maybe write again for if you haven't seen it. So Fn is here just 1 over n sum Fi squared. So what is the aim? Now, the aim is so we just fix some f star that could be one which somehow trades off bias and variance or whatever. But our aim is to look at adaptation to the active set of f star, which is those values of this penalty which are non-zero. So I want to have an estimator which behaves as if I knew those values, and that's at f star. So in general, f star will be depending on the unknown f zero. It will be an approximation of that one, so you don't know it. So you don't know this set, and you want to adapt to it. So let me write d minus s of an arbitrary function is going to be the linear combinations for which j is not in the active set. I call it active set all the time. And then remember, or maybe you don't, last time I talked about approximating the functions by a linear space. And now I just require that my linear space is a subset of the active set. I should write it in the right form. That's actually not a linear space. It's a subset of those functions for which are in the null space of D minus S. So then we write F, so the anti-projection, so the residuals after projecting a function on this linear space. This is a linear space with the dimensions on which I call n. So after projecting on this space, I'm going to look at an expansion in terms of basis functions, which I call psi j. Well, not to write this space, just forget about that, but it's on the ortho complement of that space, so that's this, times coefficients, and the coefficients are these d of f j. So I have a sort of a basis, linear combinations of these little vectors psi j orthogonal. And this basis is actually, if you're lucky, you have an inverse, but maybe you don't. So if you can invert ds d minus s transpose, then it's just this matrix. But in general, you can have that that m is here big, so that there is no inverse. And then you can use some kind of generalized inverse. Okay. Now let me recall or tell you that we had this kind of result. If you take some kind of standard choice for tuning parameter, but this will not be the tuning parameter, it will in general be smaller. And this is based on noise being Gaussian. Here's a 2. So plus 2 u bigger than 0. And that's based on the idea, I assume throughout, that the noise is Gaussian for simplicity. So, and then we had that with large probability, it was like this. V is arbitrary, U is arbitrary. And then we had something like, you can deal with the noise using this inequality. It was bounded by 1/2. Okay, you got some kind of Cauchy-Schwarz inequality where you do concentration of the chi squared, and then you get this term, Cauchy-Schwarz. And then there was the remainder term on the ortho complement of the space, where you apply the dual norm inequality. You get those functions. Then you bound the noise. And what's left over is also the coefficients, which are now d of f j. So this is more or less what we did the last time. And then I said, okay, if you take the dimension of the space n, then this term, you bounded it by the this inverse scaling factor, which behaved like in Monday's talk, like some power of 1 over the dimension. Okay, now we come finally to these dual certificates. Dual certificates. No? So most of you will probably know that if you do these kind of lasso problems, that you can use restricted eigenvalue conditions or compatibility conditions. And actually, when I was in Saint-Flour, then people pointed out to me, that was Jozef Salmon and Johan de Castro and Claire Boyer, they said, okay, but if you look at the super resolution problem, then these compatibility conditions do not hold. And that's true. And then I looked at the papers by Dalalian and Hebiri and Lederer, and also by Belek, Pierre Belek. And they had a different version of compatibility, which is completely useful also for super resolution and also for this problem. So from all these people, which I just mentioned, all French people, I got the idea to do it this way. It's well known in fact, but for me it wasn't known at the time. So let's say that the coefficients are beta star for the oracle. Then I take a vector q in the subdifferential, and that means that this vector q is always less than one. And if you look at the active set, it's the sign of And so here I just, beta S means the vector beta restricted to the set S. So that's actually outside the set S, beta star is equal to zero. So it's where it's non-zero, Q is the sign of it. And where it's zero, in general, it's less than one. And now comes the lemma, which sort of helps us to bound compatibility constants. So for weights, say less than one, and for qj, you can choose it in this subdifferential, but it has to be not just less than one, but a little bit smaller. Yeah, so on the set S, they're one or minus one, but outside the set S, I'm still free to choose them, and I choose them small. And then you have df star one minus df, f is arbitrary, plus, do I have enough space? Some wj dfj. This is bounded by, let's call it gamma, f star minus fn. So gamma is here, if you square it, it's n times the norm of d transpose q squared. So what we'll do in examples is calculate this gamma. I call it the effective sparsity. Maybe in hindsight, that's not a good name. But it's the sparsity. You can think of the size of S as the sparsity. And this is sort of, because of all kinds of correlations, the effective sparsity that you have to deal with. So if we go back one page, if you look at the basic inequality here, you see this term. Okay, where is it? And that term with the noise, you end up with something like a weighted sum outside the set S, like here. That's, so I'm going to replace this term, maybe put it in, that will be this term. So that means I can deal with the noise. I have a bound for the noise where f star minus f occurs again. And then I have an f star minus f here as well. And then, yeah, you can cancel things out. That's the idea. So why is that true? This lemma is really not a big deal. So if you look at df star minus df, and then there's a part which is kind of coming from the noise that we have to deal with, some weighted version of df, but outside the active set. Now, this, the first term is just, well, outside the set S, F star has these linear combinations equal to zero, so I can write it in this way. And it's a very standard trick now. You're going to use the triangle inequality here. Oh, that's minus then, D minus S, F plus this weighted sum. Okay, and then this term, that term you can bound by Q, element in the subdifferential. So that's like a triangle inequality, a little bit with a little step in between, but not very much more. And this term you can bound by Q of minus S transpose D minus S F. Well, F is F minus F star because F star is zero there. And so you have used this condition that the Q's are bounded by 1 minus W. So you get minus 1 plus W bounded by the Q's. Okay? So then you get Q transpose D. I can write F star minus F here. Maybe I should put the minus sign somewhere else. Well, up to minus signs. And then you apply Cauchy Schwarz. And then F star minus F N. Yeah, so then you get the result that it's bounded by gamma times or renormalized. This isn't 2 then. Yeah. 2. So now we can prove an adaptive oracle inequality. And let's call it the theorem. So you can choose your oracle in such a way that the inverse scaling factor is sufficiently small. Yeah, so depending on your choice of the tuning parameter, you get large bias or large variance. So you have to take that into account. If you want your tuning parameter to be very small, then this space should have large dimension. Okay. Then we take in this lemma, we take the weights as lambda u over lambda times these norms of the functions spanning the ortho complement of that linear space. And then, again with probability at least 1 minus, write in this way, then f hat minus f0 So here comes the approximation error. And then a term involving the approximation by this n-dimensional space and a parametric term. And this effective sparsity, here you get a squared. Okay, so if you have the size of the active set is more or less the size as of the, where is it? So this linear space is a subset of the active set. So the dimension is bigger than the size of the active set. So you want this capital N to be more or less the sparsity. So maybe 2S or 3S or something like that. But now the question is this effective sparsity here also of the right order? And that's what we'll have to check in examples. And so then this should also be more or less, if you square it, yeah, you know the typical rate log number of parameters. So the log size of the active, no, size of the active set divided by sample size and then a log term. So. So the proof is as follows, proof. So you again write down this basic inequality. That's this one, bounded by F star approximation error. And then we had the noise term. The noise term I can bound by, well, it's twice epsilon transpose and so on. So there's a factor two there. N over N. This is the Cauchy-Schwarz part. And then comes twice this dual norm inequality part. And for that, we used this lemma with the dual certificates. And we see that's bounded by gamma f hat minus f star. Okay. And that's all with this probability. So here you use the probability that is with probability like this. And for this term, the probability is at least like this. Okay, and then you say square root a times b less than, 2a times b less than a squared plus b squared. So then you get f star minus f zero squared plus this whole thing squared. Times that squared. And then you see that this term cancels with this one, and that gives the result. Okay, so now it's time for examples. And I'll start, of course, with the most simple example, and there the result is really known, so nothing new, but just to get idea, because everything what will come is based on the same idea as here. So it's on first order total variation, and then this analysis matrix looks like this. So it's just taking differences of the vector So that's a matrix with n minus one rows and n columns. And then D of F is the total variation. So. Now let's first make a basis for the whole thing. Of course, this is if you take the constant factor, then it's D of the constant factor will be zero, and that's clear. But you can find a basis for the part which is orthogonal to the null space, and we call it psi of D. Just take the whole matrix and do this operation, then you get a basis for the part which is orthogonal to the constant factor. Okay, so what my job is now to find how large these weights are and so on. So, but just a moment, I can do it simpler by looking at just at this thing. So I'll give the motivation, but I'll look at this in a minute. So let's go back. I call it psi. Oh yeah, this psi has elements psi I j. And what is that? What is it, this matrix? It's kind of nice to tell that here, because later, if you think about it, you can use it in for general graphs. So you can think of a function now as a graph with nodes 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on up to n. Like this. And now I'm asking, what is phi ij? Well, somewhere is an edge, say here, edge j. And then this is just the number of times, if you go from I to all other nodes, the number of times you visit the edge j. So it's times 1 over n. So it's 1 over n times the number of visits of j, edge j, when going from I to all other nodes. That's something which is true for general graphs, actually. Mm-hmm. If you do total variation on a general graph, you can do the same, and then it's more interesting, because then you can go from one node to another many ways, and then so you have then very many inverses. Okay, but in this case it's really simple. You say, okay, how often do I visit j? I visit j minus one times if it's less than node I. And otherwise, if I go the other direction, well, it's a signed direction, so I put a minus one, but that's not so important. The number of visits is something like n minus j. So if I look at the length of such a vector, yeah, so that's I are the rows, and then I get the n-dimensional vector. So the length is then, well, this number of points, n minus j plus 1. And here you get plus n minus j plus 1 squared times j minus 1 divided by n squared, okay, which is j minus 1 n minus j plus 1 divided by n. And to simplify, I'm going to say that's at least not larger than j minus 1. So I'm missing a factor 2 here. If I think about all these factor 2s, and so I get confused. So, but this is certainly a bound for that quantity. Okay, then, but what about our active set and so on? So, why do we need this? Well, suppose the oracle looks like this. So it is piecewise constant, and I want to adapt to the number of jumps. And so on. And so this is, say, the first jump, T1, T2, this is F star. Here's Ti minus one, here's Ti. And the distance between jumps is Ni, say. So the active set is T1 up to Ts. And the size of the active set is little s. Now, if I, and then I look at d minus s, so let me first write d again. It's -1, -1, 0, 0, 0, 0, and so on. And somewhere is 0, 0, let's say 1, -1, 0s, and so on. Here's a 0, 1, -1, and so on. So now, if I say, okay, here is a Ti, so I take it out, it's D minus S, so I cancel this row. And I do that everywhere where there's an active point. And what you then end up with, yeah, you see it happening here, then suddenly this is a block diagonal matrix with S blocks. And the blocks are all of the same form as the original matrix. So I can use for each block, I can use this formula, except that I have to replace N by Ni. Okay? Are you still there? Are you still there? Yeah? Okay. So, conclusion. If you look at the basis outside the active set, you can just take it as, or at least you can bound it by J minus one, and then the minimum. Now, instead of N, I write Ni. And this is dividing by N, so you divide by N. So what I called the inverse scaling factor is, if you take N, should you just take no additional variables, you take the linear subspace spent by the active set. Then this is just the maximum over those functions. Okay, then you have to take square roots, so you get the maximal distance between jumps. And if we want to apply the tuning parameter lambda, then we should take the number of active sets in such a way that this is at most lambda divided by lambda u. So the weights Ti minus 1 plus j are going to be these quantities, but we renormalize them so that they are between 0 and 1. So it becomes something like, so that you see it more clearly. You take square roots of these functions normalized so that they are between 0 and 1. Okay, so let's draw a picture. Here's the points 1 up to n. And then there are some active points. Maybe like this. So this is the first one, T1, T2, T3, and so on. So I want now a vector Q, let's call it an interpolating vector. It has to be equal to the sign where there's where it's active, so it has to be here, it has to go through these points here. And in between, it should be bounded by one minus these weights. And these weights behave like square roots. So this function Q maybe looks like this. And then you're okay. So, but it's important that here it goes down like square root. And also you don't want boundary effects. So you want it to be zero at the last point. So you go the same way, maybe. And if there are two successive active points, so where the function jumps, but this so jumps in the same direction, so it's like a monotone piece, then you don't care. You just have to be sure that you go down enough, but you don't have to go down all the way to zero. I should draw it symmetrically, then it looks nicer. So it may be like this. So if I don't want to write too much, I just say, okay, let's rescale and write the continuous version. Then this function in the continuous version, just for the sake of easier to see, huh? It's a rescaled version of a function of this form. At least when the jumps are of different, in different directions. Huh? So when there is a jump up and a jump down, you use this kind of function, and it looks like this. And then if you look at D transpose Q, well, let's just look at it at such a piece. So from on such a piece where there's a jump, roughly speaking, it's just 1 over ni. So this is just partial integration. It's just taking the derivative. And then we square it. Yeah, so the derivative of a square root is 1 over the square root. If you square it, you get 1 over x. So you get something like the integral of 1 over x, which is log, a log function. Yeah, so this is, I think, 1 over ni. I think it's log, maybe ni over 2. So conclusion. At least it is a bound. And D transpose Q. D transpose Q is just taking derivatives, and then you get some, and so there are s plus 1 pieces, you get this, so the distance between jumps plays an important role as soon as there, the signs are changing. If they are of the same sign, you get something else, you are better off. So if the function is monotone, then you don't have an assumption about the distance between jumps is not needed. So what this all gives you, that if you look at the result, where is it? And so if you now apply this theorem, now we have a bound for gamma, and the n is in this example just the size of the active set, and gamma where is it? Gamma here. So if you have roughly equidistant points, if this is more or less S, then gamma is more or less S squared. So not really the sparsity, but the sparsity squared. And then there's this log, let's say put a log like that. But you can take, here it is, the tuning parameter can then be of order. And then there's this another lock here. And that will then give you lambda squared gamma squared, something of order S log squared n divided by n. Oh, there's here, so divided by n. And so that's indeed, then you have adaptation to the number of jumps in the oracle. You can get rid of a lock here in this particular example, but in the other examples, I don't know how to do it. And I don't know, I haven't seen any results where there was no lock. So, well. Okay. So here's another example, second order total variation. So it goes the same way now for all other examples. There's nothing really new except that you have to do one little step. So we take second order derivatives. And so on. So then D of F is the sum. Well, you have to start at 3, otherwise there is nothing to do. And then you look at the differences of the differences. Yeah, so select discrete second order derivative. And these differences are Fj minus 1. Yeah, so you use this kind of analysis matrix if you believe that your function is piecewise linear or well approximated by a piecewise linear function. Now we can use the same trick. What is a good basis? Well, you again take d transpose inverse. And if you look at this matrix, you see that's a little bit more work, but that it's rows, sorry, it's columns. Behave like before it was just this term, but now it's this term to the power 3. That's for the total variation. You had power 1, now you have a power 3, the minimum of those two. So now let's see. Now I'm going to remove those active points. So f star is maybe like this. So piecewise linear. Maybe like that. And where it has a kink, that's the active point. And so on. And then I look again at the matrix D. So it's with all these columns. Let's write one column here. So this is maybe an active row, and then comes the next row, then comes the next one, so on. So if this one is Ti, I remove it, and then I get D minus S. And now you see that you don't have a block diagonal matrix. So what I just do is I remove its neighbor as well. And then I have a block diagonal matrix consisting of blocks again. With the same structure as the original matrix. And for the original matrix, I did the calculations, so I just had to replace n here by ni, the distance between kinks. Yeah, so it's all the same exercise in a way. So going to a new slide. So in this case, I'm not going to take just the active points, but I take all linear combinations of the active points. These are the active points. And in addition, their neighbors. So that means that the dimension of B is now, okay, there's a TS, TS plus one. I'm not completely sure, but anyway, the dimension, if you do the calculations right, the last point you can consider also as an active point or the first point. And then there's also the linear part and the constant part. Oh no, this one doesn't occur. There's also a linear part and a constant part. So if you do the calculations, it's roughly 2s, but it turns out to be 2s plus 1 exactly. So you really have to enlarge the space a little bit, but it's still of the same order. So that's fine. And then if you go to here you have your weights. You put them in these blocks, except that you make them local weights. And so you get powers, you just take the square root, so you get powers 3 over 2 in the weights. And then, so the function in the subdifferential, if I write it in a continuous version locally per area, instead of the square root, you get 3 over 2. So that's just, again, you make it symmetric around the midpoint of such an interval. But again, the idea is that you have, if you have two active points, going from plus 1 to minus 1, then the function which interpolates that is again of a certain form. That's not very successful. So it has this particular form, which is a weighted and rescaled version of what I'm writing here, and it's a discrete version. Yeah, so this is ti minus 1, ti. Then, and again, D transpose Q. If you restrict it to such an interval, it's roughly, well, after normalization, the second derivative now. So just in a few of time, I'm not going to write it too precisely. But you just take second derivatives, and that's again just twice partial integration, and make sure that at the border you don't have border effects. So you have to make sure that the function goes to zero, and that near zero also the derivatives vanish, and so on. But that's all fine. And so then if you do the same arguments, the second derivative of this function will give you a log term. So gamma is going to be n sum I equals 1 to s plus 1. And then you get n to the power 3 and log terms up to constants because of some discretization arguments and so on. So that gives you, again, if the kinks are equally distant, then you get, you adapt and you get the usual adaptation just for the lasso, except that there's an additional log term. So if you go to higher dimensions, let me just give you one example how it goes. So I just looked at the case k equals 1. Just the first order derivatives, second order derivatives, and you can do it for general k. But you can also do it for general dimensions. So, for instance, if I take k equals 1 and d equals 2, then I look at a function like this, two-dimensional index, so to speak. And we do an ANOVA decomposition. It's the average plus the average over k minus the average plus the average over j minus the average, and then plus the interaction term. So this is an ANOVA decomposition. And this is just a constant term. You can estimate it with rate 1 over square root of n. And then you penalize the main effects and the interaction terms. And so the penalty is some tuning parameter times the total variation of the main effects minus 1. And then there's the other main effect, and then there's another term, which is the interaction terms. Let's see, like this. Okay. And that penalty, with that, you have, again, this is my, you can just, because these, if you do this decomposition, each term is orthogonal to the other, so you can just do an analysis of each term separately. And the overall mean is orthogonal to the main effects, and the main effects are orthogonal to the interactions. So you can just do a separate analysis. And if you do the analysis for the interaction terms, you get, you have to do the same idea. So let me just try to draw a picture, maybe like this. So you have a two-dimensional grid, so to speak. Yeah, and then let's say for simplicity, for instance, here you have square root n points, and here you have square root n points, so that in total you have n points. And then somewhere is the active set. Maybe one jump up and one jump down here. And what you do is you go from one jump up to one jump down. This is, say, minus 1. This is plus 1. You go down in two dimensions, and then the function q will look like this. It will be a rescaled version of, let me write it. It's 1 minus x. So the square roots are again because of the L1 norm is the L2 norm is the square root of the L1 norm. So if you go down in one direction, say in this direction here, maybe you have to go down further, I don't know, but if you do that, you have this little square. Or maybe it's a rectangle, and then an active point, and then there are four rectangles around it, and in each rectangle you do such an interpolation. Making sure that at the border it's zero again to avoid border effects. Okay, so here you see if you have, if you take kth order differences, so total variation of the k minus 1 order, you get exactly the same type of results. So this is still in one dimension. For instance, if you look at fourth order differences, then you have to interpolate between minus 1 and 1 again, or between 1. So this is the first half of such an interval. And what I do, I split it in three parts to make sure that at here it goes down sufficiently quickly, but it has to go down all the way down to minus 1 here. So here it will be, so it will have a function which has four derivatives or discrete derivatives, but it's piecewise here at these pieces. All three derivatives mentioned, the fourth derivative gives you a jump. And that will then be the involved in the effective sparsity. And in higher dimensions, I showed you this picture. So this is just a very simple example in two dimensions, total variation penalty. This is the original picture. This is the noisy version. And then because there is only finitely many jumps, say 2, you really see that the rate of convergence is more or less quadratic for the estimator. That's what we see in our simulations. Maybe I stop here. What is this? Why is it empty? I don't know if I can go down that quickly. So there's also this theory for graphs. What I just said for the path graphs, so total variation just in one dimension, you can do the same for graphs in general. And then you have to count all the time the number of ways to go from one node to the other and then find out how often you use an edge. And that will give you the weight in the effective sparsity. So one example is this one. Here you see indeed if you go from one node to another, there are so many ways to do that. If you take the most direct way, you get weights which are too big, and then you will not get really nice effective sparsity. But for instance, in this case, when you have just the original picture is just consisting of two parts. And then so at this border, there are jumps. So there are square root n jumps. So you may wonder, is the rate just two parts? So it's just dimension is two. So you would maybe the rate is 2/n. But there are square root n jumps. Maybe the rate is square root n over n. Well, that last one is actually the minimax rate up to log terms, maybe. And if you adapt to this simple picture, you can, by the same arguments which I told you just before, you get this rate, log to the power 3 over n power 3/4. And that's actually the right rate of convergence. So you can adapt to such a single picture and proof theoretical adaptation using, again, exactly the same arguments as I used in the handwriting. Okay, so conclusion. These examples are all about highly correlated design. And these interpolations of the signs are very useful for structured problems. And so they are there an improvement of restricted eigenvalue conditions. And finally, you can also extend everything to other loss functions. And there's just no additional problems there. Thank you very much for your patience and your attention.
Okay, Sarah, thank you. Unfortunately, I didn't find the applause button.
No.
Everybody would join me to thank you for a very nice presentation, very clear and very inspiring.
Thank you.
We are all convinced that you can do much more than you showed with your technique. And probably it's a good inspiration to learn more about.
Okay.
Yeah. So now there is already a question in the chat. Sarah, can you see the question from Natalia?
Yeah. Thank you. Okay. These types of penalties are used a lot in inverse problem. That's a very good question, Natalia. I think so. But I looked at some of these papers and they're really the applied versions. And then it's not so easy for me to find out what kind of, criterion they have that they're more or less minimizing or so. But you're right, and I think it's possible to, because they have all these total variations in all types of forms in their work. Yeah, so I hope something to investigate.
Still something to do. More questions? So everybody can use the microphone or write the question in chat, so it's all possible. So, what about adaptation to the noise?
To the noise in what sense?
Yeah, I mean, do you need to know the noise level?
Well, we have a paper where we show that you can do square root lasso. Mm. So, square root lasso would work. It's not immediate. You have to do a little bit of proving, but it's possible. Yeah.
Okay, some more questions. So there is a question from one organizer about isotonic regression.
Yeah, can I use for? I think indeed Pierre Belec did it, and if there are no if there are no jumps, then there you don't have to do this complicated interpolation. So then you just get adaptation to the number of jumps of an isotonic function. The only thing is that at the border that counts for me as a jump. So there should not be a jump right at the start or at the very end of the sequence. But otherwise, you can adapt. If there are very many little jumps after each other, that doesn't hurt at all. And yeah, yes, that can be done. Thank you.